The Lord has given me a well-trained tongue.
Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave.
Cannot pass me by without my drinking it. Your will be done.
Some of the people who are still in the church. And so if you would just kind of maybe spread out a little bit so I can get in amongst you to bless the palms when we get to that point. Dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal Mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Almighty and ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ, the King and exaltation, may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A proclamation from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus and the disciples drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find an ass tethered and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them here to me. And if anyone should say anything to you, reply, 'The master has need of them.' Then he will send them at once." This happened so that what had been spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled. "Say to daughter Zion, behold, your king comes to you, meek and riding on an ass, and on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." The disciples went and did as Jesus had ordered them. They brought the ass and the colt and laid their cloaks over them, and he sat upon them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and strewed them on the road. The crowds preceding him and those following kept crying out and saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was shaken and asked, "Who is this?" And the crowds replied, "This is Jesus the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I'd like to just pause a brief moment over this Gospel In biblical times, this scene would have been very familiar to people because conquering kings would enter cities in a similar way. There would be great acclamation from the people, the waving of branches, the spreading of their cloaks on the path. But there were two major differences. One difference was the conquering king would be riding on a war horse. Jesus is riding on a beast of burden, a donkey, a symbol of peace. No horse of war. And secondly, the conquering king would have strong, mighty, and powerful armies. Jesus had none of the sort. Jesus conquered by his obedience, by his response to the call of his heavenly Father to non-violently confront everything that worked against humanity, suffering, sin, and death itself. And so we enter into that same spirit of welcoming Jesus as our conquering king. He conquers our sin, our selfishness, even our mortality. So this is more than just a walk down memory lane being nostalgic. This is us today, in step with Jesus. We've been following him for 40 days. We continue to follow him through the unfolding of the mystery of Holy Week. We continue to allow the Lord to lead us to be the best version of ourselves that we can be. And so, my sisters and brothers, like the crowds who acclaimed Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace. So please follow the banner carriers, and I encourage you to wave your palms in praise and thanksgiving to our God.
And follow those carriers all the way down and around, down the center aisle, and then find a place to sit.
Thank you. We pray for a moment in the quiet of our hearts. O God of eternal glory, you anointed Jesus, your servant, to bear our sins, to encourage the weary, to raise up and restore the fallen. Keep before our eyes the splendor of the Paschal mystery of Christ, and by our sharing in the Passion and the Resurrection, seal our lives with the victorious sign of his obedience and exaltation. We ask this through Christ, our liberator from sin, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, holy and mighty God, forever and ever.
Amen.
I invite forward the children in the fifth grade and younger for your liturgy of the word. Fifth grade and younger. This is our final week to prepare to celebrate the dying and rising of Jesus, and so we have a very powerful gospel to read and to celebrate of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem and Jesus bringing good news to people through his life, through his dying and rising. And so I send you with the word of God to celebrate the dying and rising of Jesus on this Palm Sunday. Go in the peace of Christ.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a well-trained tongue, that I may know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ears that I may hear, and I have not rebelled and have not turned back. I give my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who pluck my beard, my face I have not shielded from buffets and spitting. The Lord is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of our Lord.
A proclamation from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that the name of Jesus every knee should bend, and of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. One of the 12, whose name was Judas Iscariot, went off to the chief priests.
What are you willing to give me if I hand over Jesus to you?
They paid him 30 pieces of silver. And from that time on, Judas kept looking for an opportunity to hand Jesus over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came up to Jesus and said,
"Where do you wish us to prepare the Passover supper for you?"
"Go to this man in the city and tell him, 'The teacher says my appointed time draws near. I am to celebrate the Passover with my disciples in your house.'"
The disciples then did as Jesus had ordered and prepared the Passover supper. When it grew dark, he reclined at the table with the 12. In the course of the meal, he said,
"I give you my word. One of you is about to betray me."
Distressed at this, they began to say to one another,
Surely it is not I, Lord.
The one who has dipped his hand into the dish with me is the one who will hand me over. The Son of Man is departing as Scripture says of him. But woe to that person by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It were better for that one if he had never been born.
Then Judas, his betrayer, spoke.
Surely it is not I, Rabbi.
It is you, Judas. You who have said it.
During the meal, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples.
Take this and eat it. This is my body.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them.
All of you must drink from it, for this is my blood, the blood of the covenant, to be poured out in behalf of many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink this fruit of the vine from now until the day I drink the new wine with you in my Father's reign.
After singing songs of praise, they walked out to the Mount of Olives. Jesus said to them,
tonight, your faith in me will be shaken. For Scripture has it, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be dispersed. But after I am raised up, I will go to Galilee ahead of you.
Peter responded,
though all may have their faith in you shaken, mine will never be shaken.
Peter, I give you my word. Before the cock crows tonight, you will deny me 3 times.
Even though I have to die with you, I will never disown you.
And all the other disciples said the same. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane. He said to his disciples,
stay here while I go over there and pray.
He took along Peter and Zebedee's 2 sons and began to experience sorrow and distress. He said to them,
my heart is nearly broken with sorrow. Remain here and stay awake with me.
He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer.
My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass me by. Still, let it be as you would have it, not as I.
When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
so you could not stay awake with me for even an hour? Be on guard and pray that you may not undergo the trial. The spirit is willing, but nature is weak.
Withdrawing a second time, he began to pray.
My Father, if this cup cannot pass me by without my drinking it, your will be done.
Once more, upon his return, he found them asleep. They could not keep their eyes open. He left them again, withdrew somewhat, and began to pray a third time, saying the same words as before. Finally, he returned to his disciples and said to them,
sleep on now. Enjoy your rest. The hour is upon us when the Son of Man is to be handed over to the power of evil ones. Get up. Let us be on our way. See? My betrayer is here.
While he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived accompanied by a great crowd with swords and clubs. They had been sent by the chief priests and elders of the people. His betrayer had arranged to give them a signal, saying,
"One I pray, one, take hold."
He immediately went over to Jesus and said to him,
"Peace, Rabbi,"
and embraced him. Jesus answered,
"Do what you are here for, friend."
At that moment, they stepped forward to lay hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those who accompanied Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and slashed at the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. Jesus said to him,
"Put back your sword where it belongs. Those who use the sword are sooner or later destroyed by it. Do you not suppose that I could call upon my Father to provide at a moment's notice more than 12 legions of angels? But then, how would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen this way?"
At that very time, Jesus said to the crowd,
"Am I a brigand that you have come armed with swords and clubs to arrest me? Day after day, I sat teaching in your temple precincts, yet you never arrested me. Nonetheless, all of this has happened in the fulfillment of the writings of the prophets."
Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
Those who had apprehended Jesus led him off to Caiaphas the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were convened. Peter kept following him at a distance at the high priest's residence. Going inside, he sat down with the guards to see the outcome. The chief priests with the whole Sanhedrin were busy trying to obtain false testimony against Jesus so they could put him to death. They discovered none, despite the many false witnesses who took the stand. Finally, two came forward who stated,
"This man has declared he can destroy God's sanctuary and rebuild it in 3 days."
The high priest rose to his feet and addressed him,
"Have you no answer to the charges leveled against you?"
But Jesus remained silent. The high priest then said to him,
"I order you, under oath, before the living God, are you the Messiah, the Son of God?"
"It is you who say it. But I tell you this, soon you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
At this, the high priest tore his robes.
"He has blasphemed. We have no further need of any more witnesses. You heard the blasphemy. What verdict do you give to this man?"
"He deserves death.
Death.
Then they began to spit in his face and hit him. Others slapped him, saying,
Peter was sitting in the courtyard when one of the serving girls came over to him and said,
"You too were with Jesus the Galilean."
I don't know what you're talking about.
When he went out to the gate, another girl saw him and said to those nearby,
"This man was with Jesus, the Nazarene."
Again, he denied it with an oath.
"I don't know the man."
A little while later, some bystanders came over to Peter and said,
"You certainly are the one."
"Why? Why, even your accent gives you away.
At that, he began cursing and swore,
I don't even know the man.
Then a rooster began to crow, and Peter remembered the prediction Jesus had made. Before the rooster crows, you will 3 times disown me. He went out and began to weep bitterly.
At daybreak, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took formal action against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him and led him away to be handed over to Pilate. Then Judas, who had handed him over, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, began to regret his action deeply. He took the 30 pieces of silver back to the chief priests and elders and said,
I did wrong to deliver an innocent man.
They retorted,
what is that to us? It is your affair.
So Judas flung the money into the temple and left. After consultation, they used it to buy a potter's field for a cemetery for foreigners. That is why that field, even today, is called Blood Field. On that occasion, what was said through the Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. They took the 30 pieces of silver, the value of a man with a price on his head, a price set by the Israelites, and they paid it out for the potter's field, just as the Lord had commanded me. Jesus was arraigned before Pilate, who questioned him,
are you the king of the Jews?
As you say.
Yet when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he had made no reply. Then Pilate said to him,
surely you must realize all the charges that they have brought against you?
Jesus did not answer him on a single count, much to Pilate's surprise. Now, on the occasion of a festival, Pilate was accustomed to releasing one prisoner whom the crowd would designate. They had at a time a notorious prisoner named Barabbas. Since they were already assembled, Pilate said to them,
which one do you wish for me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, the so-called Messiah?
He knew, of course, it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was still presiding on the bench, his wife sent him a message.
Do not interfere in the case of that holy man. I had a dream about him today, which has greatly upset me.
Meanwhile, the chief priests and elders convinced the crowds that they should ask for Barabbas and have Jesus put to death. So Pilate asked them,
so which one do you want me to release to you?
Barabbas!
Then what am I to do with Jesus? Why? What crime has he committed?
Pilate finally realized he was making no impression and that a riot was breaking out instead. He called for water and washed his hands in front of the crowd, declaring as he did so,
I am innocent of the blood of this innocent man.
Let this blood be on us.
At that, he released Barabbas to them. Jesus, however, was scourged and was handed over to be crucified. Pilate's soldiers took Jesus inside the praetorium and collected the whole cohort around him. They stripped off his clothes and wrapped him in a scarlet military cloak. Weaving a crown of thorns, they fixed it on his head and stuck a reed in his right hand. They began to mock him by dropping to their knees before him, saying,
"All hail, King of the Jews!"
They also spat on him. Afterward, they took the reed and kept striking him on the head. Finally, when they had finished making a fool of him, they stripped him of his cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him off to crucifixion. On their way, they met a Cyrenian named Simon. This man they pressed into service to carry the cross. They arrived at a site called Golgotha, a place which means skull place. They gave him a drink of wine flavored with gall, which he tasted but refused to drink. When they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among them by casting lots. They sat down and kept watch over him. Above his head, they had put the charge against him in writing, "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." Two insurgents were crucified along with him, one at his right and one at his left. People kept going by insulting him, tossing their heads and saying,
"So, you're the one that's going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days?
Save yourself, why don't you? Come down off that cross if you are God's son."
The chief priests, the scribes, and the elders joined in the jeering.
"He saved others, but he cannot save himself."
"So he is the King of Israel. Let's see him come down from that cross. Then we will believe in him."
"He relied on God, so let God rescue him now if he wants to."
"After all, he claimed, 'I am God's son.'"
The insurgents who had been crucified with him kept taunting him in the same way. From noon onward, there was a darkness over the whole land until mid-afternoon. Then Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani,"
which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" This made some of the bystanders who heard it remark,
"He's invoking Elijah."
Immediately, one of them ran off and got a sponge. He soaked it in cheap wine and, sticking it on a reed, tried to make him drink. Meanwhile, the rest said,
"Leave him alone. Let's see whether Elijah comes to his rescue."
Once again, Jesus cried out in a loud voice and gave up his spirit. Suddenly, the curtain of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. Many bodies of saints who had fallen asleep were raised. The centurion and those who were keeping watch over Jesus were terror-stricken at seeing the earthquake and all that was happening. The centurion said,
"Clearly, clearly this was the Son of God, the Son of God."
Many women were present, looking on from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee to attend to his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joses, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. When evening fell, a wealthy man from Arimathea arrived, Joseph by name. He was another of Jesus' disciples and had gone to request the body of Jesus. Thereupon, Pilate issued an order for its release. Taking the body, Joseph wrapped it in fresh linen and laid it in his own new tomb, which had been hewn from a formation of rock. Then he rolled a huge stone across the entrance of the tomb and went away. But Mary Magdalene and the other Mary remained sitting there, facing the tomb. The next day, the one following the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees called at Pilate's residence.
Sir, we have recalled that the impostor, while he was still alive, made the claim, "After 3 days, I will rise." You should issue an order having the tomb kept under surveillance until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him and tell the people he has been raised from the dead. This final imposture would be worse than the first.
Pilate told them,
"You have guards. Go and secure the tomb as best you can."
So they went and kept it under the surveillance of the guard after fixing a seal to the stone. The Gospel of our Lord.
We have begun our entrance into the most solemn week of the entire year. With prayers of petition, we pray that this year's Holy Week might further transform our world into the kingdom of God.
Our response is, "Hear us, O Lord." For peace, for the children of Abraham, Jews, Christians, and Muslims, on whose holy sites and shrines there is war and unimaginable suffering, may the world know that God is and God cares. O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
for those living with heavy crosses to bear, for those sick or suffering, lonely or anxious, struggling with loss or fear of loss, may they know that God is and God cares. O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
For all who are preparing for Easter sacraments around the world, and for our youth confirmation candidates, may they stand firm in their faith, knowing that God is and God cares. O God, we pray.
Yes, Lord.
For all who struggle to remain faithful in marriage and family, in service and stewardship to the church, in jobs and leadership, may they know that God is and God cares. O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
For the most vulnerable, for children and those yet to be born, for the very old and those without meaningful work or companionship, for those struggling with addiction or mental illness, O God, we pray. For our archdiocesan synod process, may we speak with a well-trained tongue in planning for the future. O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
Let us pause to pray for ourselves as we enter this Holy Week. For what we need to become the best version of ourselves as God intends us to be. O God, we pray.
Hear us, Lord.
We remember, too, those who are signed in our Book of Life, for Betty Jane Mason, who recently died, and especially James Lapine and Frank Warner, for whom this sacrifice is offered. O God, we pray.
Gracious God, you so love the world that you gave us your Son Jesus to be our Savior. Hear these our prayers and help us to walk in step as his disciples, emptying ourselves so as to come to the fullness of life with you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
And as we present our gifts, let us all sing together on page 30, Take Up Your Cross.
Pray, friends, that these are gifts, the many gifts of Holy Week, may all be acceptable to God, our loving Father. Amen. Lord, through the passion of your only begotten Son, draw near to us with your forgiveness, that we who can merit nothing of ourselves may, through the unique sacrifice of Christ, experience the healing power of your mercy. Grant this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ. Though he was sinless, he suffered willingly for sinners. Though innocent, he accepted condemnation to save the guilty. By his dying, he washed away our sins. By his rising from the dead, he won justification for us all. And so with all the angels and the saints, we sing the joyful hymn of your praise. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup, and once more giving thanks, gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me."
Thank you.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the cup of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and serve you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring us to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Jerome and Donald, our bishops, and all who serve your people. Remember our loved ones who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Joseph, her spouse, the apostles, Saint James, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may come to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him.
We can approach our God in confidence because we use the words Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
May the peace of the Lord Jesus be with you always. We share with one another a sign of the Lord's peace. Behold the Lamb of God, broken, poured out for us all. How blessed are we called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus bring us to life everlasting. I invite forward the ministers of communion for the homebound. We're very grateful you're able to bring the Eucharist to those who can't be here to help them as well enter into this Holy Week and come to know the Lord more deeply. And so we send you with our prayer for them. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. You thought you weren't getting a homily. No. I just want to be inclusive today. In case you were not here last weekend, we began a special project, kind of a follow-up of our Lenten book, The Four Signs of a Dynamic Catholic. We gave everyone one of these little notebooks last week. If you did not receive your little notebook last week, there should be notebooks in the little containers in your pews. So if you didn't get one, please take one along. And what we're going to do is use these each week, and we're going to kind of answer the prayer on the cover here. And the prayer says, God, show me one way in this Mass how I can become a better version of myself this week. And so each Mass then on the weekend, we will pause after the communion ministers are completed and pause to take a moment to jot down a little phrase, a word, a sentence, something that you can take with you from this celebration of the Mass that will help you be a better version of yourself in the coming week, and just to jot it down in here. And we're going to do that for at least the next several months to give us a chance to sort of follow up on our Lenten discussion, Lenten reading of the four dynamics, the four signs of a dynamic Catholic. And so we'll just take a moment now. If you have something you'd like to jot down in here, let's just take a moment to do that right now. Lord, you have fed us with this holy food, and through the death of your Son, have inspired us to hope for what our faith promises. Lead us by his resurrection to the haven we so earnestly desire, for we pray through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Good morning. These are our pulpit announcements. We will begin accepting donations for our annual thrift sale soon. A list of needed items can be found in the bulletin and on Facebook. Blood pressure screening will take place after Masses this weekend in the Great Room. The aluminum can trailer is here this weekend. All proceeds benefit this summer's mission trip. Come to our Holy Week celebrations beginning at 7 p.m. Thursday evening. Experience with our lectors and music ministry the Passion of Jesus at 1 p.m. on Friday. And of course, the joyous celebration of the Resurrection at 8 p.m. on Saturday. Guests and visitors are invited to stop back at the Welcome Center and ask questions or talk with the parish council member. See the bulletin, website, and Facebook for more information about activities here at St. James.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to complete the journey of Lent.
Amen. And as we go forth, let us sing on page 28, Lord, Let Me Walk, verses 1 and 3.